start lah.
Start ready.
Okay.
Okay. Hello. Hi. Welcome to the podcast. This is the Macha Man podcast. We've been getting some very good traction lately lah.
No, because you got nothing to do, stuck in the house, so might as well, right?
Yala, exactly. So we decided to do one more episode for you guys. So hey, you know, count your lucky stars lah.
How many of that do they have already by now?
I mean, not the problem is everything else is not lucky because, I mean, you know what's happening in, you know, the country right now. So, yala.
The COVID is to pay, the country is to pay.
Yala, every government also. We don't know who's
what government.
Doing what now.
What government?
Exactly. Good point. Very good point. So let's start off with some laughter.
If anybody is wondering, we're recording this on the 17th of August.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's one day after the supposed prime minister resign.
Yes, and to be fair, he did everything in his power to keep power.
Yeah,
all but not including doing his actual job.
He came out and said he did everything he could, according to him lah.
Yeah. No. Did you see that according to him speech not?
Yeah.
You know, like he won an academy. I swear to God, like someone was going to come out with a lifetime achievement award or something, you know.
No, you wait, like I think they're gonna give him a parade from the Deka watch.
No, but why? At the end, why did he, like, you know, this is the weirdest part, like, at the end he just went, thank you to my wife.
My wife?
Like, no, I mean, look. I mean, God bless her, whatever, you know, all that. She's a nice person, I guess. But why?
No. Because as imagine, the whole country don't like him. Okay? The entire country don't like him. If he didn't thank his wife, he have to go back home and there's somebody else there also they don't like him. No? So at least the least he could do was that.
Least he could do is go back to someone who actually can tolerate him.
Because at least if we go home, we don't have to deal with that with like an added headache, you know.
Okay, so let's start off with the Macha news.
Yes, okay. Today's Macha news.
No jingle.
Again.
No jingle. La.
No ni.
Okay. I want
jingle
to.
God. Tingle.
La. You want tingle or you want jingle?
I want tingle.
Tingling jingle. La. Tingling, ling, 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 ling. Okay, that again. I'm sorry.
Wasted. Wasted everybody. Spotify has limited storage, you know, and you wasted for that.
No. You know it's not stored in Spotify, right?
No. It is. It's the internet only has a set amount of storage and you wasted however many kilobytes just for that. You happy or not with yourself?
No, I'm very disappointed with myself right now. Uh-huh. I would like to thank my wife. Sticking to it, you know. And I would like to thank my father, my mother. And I've done a good job. I've done a good job for 34 episodes. It's just episode, I'm very disappointed.
Your wife has filed a motion of no confidence on you.
I wish I could file a like bowel motion. No.
Bad, nowadays?
Oh, yeah. Hey, look, listen. Okay, I've not been on stage for, how long already? Year and a half?
17 years.
Yeah. My system also don't know what to do already.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, suddenly my back pain. Not for anything, you know, just pain. It's just pain.
No, because got nothing to do, right? So, might as well, you know?
Yeah, I know. It's just weird, lah. This
suddenly,
suddenly my Achilles tendon will swell up. Suddenly, out of nowhere.
And you won't be doing anything to, like, strain it also, right? And
then I'm sleeping, bro.
Yeah, correct.
If I was sleeping and I was dreaming that I was mountain climbing or something, I can understand. No,
yeah.
I was sleeping and I was dreaming that I was sleeping.
It's because your body, right? We're stuck in the house, nothing to do. The body just feels it's bored, you know.
Yeah.
So I just pain and then see what happens.
Maybe you'll pay more attention to me.
Okay. So, Macha News, as usual, I managed to find some news from midday.com.
Oh, our favorite publication.
our premier Indian publication for nonsense news.
Yes.
Unfortunately, most of the news is very short.
Mm-hmm.
So I will do one.
Mm-hmm.
And then you tell me if it's enough or not. If it's not enough, I'll do one more. Okay?
Okay. Okay. Can.
So this news is from the 8th of August, the year there's no more Lord 2021.
The year the Lord has...
No more.
He's given up.
No, he's not there.
He's left.
He went to the Lord. you figure out how that works.
He went to HR.
He quit. And the story goes, robbers who wore raincoats used toy guns for crimes arrested from Uttar Pradesh.
Okay. You're going to have to repeat that again. One more time.
Okay. Robbers who wore raincoats.
Raincoats. Okay.
Used toy guns for crimes.
Mm-hmm.
Arrested from Uttar Pradesh.
Okay. Uttar Pradesh, as we know, is the Florida of
I assume so, la, but yes. Most of our news comes from there for some reason.
Yes. Uttar Pradesh is killing it, la, in the news.
They should get some award, la, for this.
But okay, I'm sure there is some sort of, like, why raincoats? Like, is that a uniform or something? Or?
Okay, so two notorious robbers.
Notorious.
Who wore raincoats and used toy guns for their crimes were arrested by the Delhi police, okay? From Karnal in Haryana and Noida in Uttar. I don't know why they got different police people coming in and just to arrest two people, but whatever.
This is like in one step below Interpol.
Yes.
This is Interpol.
Interpol, yeah. The accused were identified as Dheeraj, a resident of Panipat, and Pankaj from Madhubani, Bihar.
Their name's not very creative, huh? Dheeraj and
Pankaj.
Pankaj. Both the so, like, you know, there's like a like Bonnie and Clyde feel to it, like Dheeraj and Pankaj.
So I think maybe they were like childhood friends, and these are the two fellas that nobody wanted to be friends with in school, no?
Because they're constantly wearing fucking raincoat and toy guns.
The duo used to target various cash for gold shops for their crimes.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
No, to be fair, yeah. If you had to commit a crime,
okay,
those are the shops that you should, you know.
Correct. But yes. Usually, you know, if you want to do crime and all that, you would train, you would do research and all that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. They were also inspired by the Crime Patrol TV serial and had watched YouTube videos of many robberies. So,
listen, again, the Indian YouTube videos are fucking amazing, bro.
So, there's an Indian, if for people who don't know, there are Indian guides, Indian YouTube guides for anything.
Anything.
And now, apparently, I think also robberies.
and they are awesome, like, you know, okay, I've been dabbling with Photoshop, right? And look, when you want to do something, all you have to do is put the what you want to do on YouTube, and one Indian fellow will teach you how to do it. No,
yes, yes. Good. Yes, like, yes, they're all good.
And look, you can go to the white people. Okay, I'm not saying anything, but you can go to the white people. They also good.
But they'll talk a lot of cock.
They cannot explain properly. They will expect you to know, like, click here. Like, you're like, oh, okay, now mind. But you go to the Indian one, the fellow will be like, you know, like, you will do this and you will do that. And then you will take this and you will make a new frame. And then and suddenly you're like, fuck, I can do this.
It's like he's right there next to you.
And he's very gentle, you know.
Yeah.
Right?
It's all that one fella, I think.
I think it's the same fella.
It's all that one fella. Shop.
He does video editing. He does fixing your PlayStation.
Yeah.
Anything. And dropping a gold shop.
Robbing gold shop, yeah. So both accused had committed a robbery in a cash for gold shop in Greater Kailash on July 30th. They had stolen 70 to 75,000 rupiahs in cash from the shop.
Rupees.
What did I say?
Rupiahs.
Okay.
Because 75,000 rupiahs is not even worth the paper it's printed on.
That is true. Sorry, I got the thing mixed. Rupees.
Rupees.
I don't care, lah.
75,000 rupees is about 5,000 ringgit.
Okay. Good
about
for them.
Della.
Good. Police stations of CR Park and Maidan Gahi came together to form a team to nab the culprits. Okay.
Yo, this is like Starsky and Hutch.
Yeah, this is a massive mobilization ready.
Oh, yo. For 5,000 bucks, you know.
For
5,000 ringgit.
No, for two idiots in raincoat, no.
And toy guns.
They checked the premises of the shop looted by the duo, finding out that they wore raincoats, helmets, gloves, and masks at the time of the crime and had come out on a white scooty with a defective number plate.
It's white scooty.
Yeah, scooty.
What's a scooty?
Based on CCTV footage, they were found roaming in Kalkaji market. Hold on. I'm not finished. There are a few more markets coming. Okay. They were found roaming in Kalkaji market,
okay,
Lajpat Nagar market, Nizamuddin market,
okay,
and GK1 market, searching for more cash for gold shops.
Oh, okay. I thought they were just going on a spending spree in markets. I mean, just like, hey, we got some cash. What do? We go to market, bro.
Let's buy vegetables.
Vegetables. This is how we're going to spend the loot, okay? We're going to buy vegetables and then we're going to fence the vegetables. Okay, like, you just imagine like Ocean's 11 like that. Like, you know, they go and rob the cash for gold, right? And then after that, come back and then go to the market, buy carrot, like 75,000 rupees worth of carrot. And then keep the carrot because that cannot be traced, what, the carrot?
Yeah. You cannot trace. There's no carrot trail.
Exactly. So after the heat dies down, they sell the carrot.
Okay. Correct. See?
That's how you do, bro.
But, I mean, don't so obviously buy vegetables that you'll get caught.
Don't buy 75,000 rupees of carrots. You know how much you'll get? You know how many carrots you're going to buy?
That's a lot of carrots.
That's a lot of carrots. Yeah. And one go bad, you're screwed.
So, yeah. Then after that, a similar robbery in Kalkaji market on the same scooty on 6 January this year was revealed during the search. After the accused were identified, Dheeraj was arrested from Karnal and the other from Noida.
Mm-hmm.
Both had planned to commit another robbery in Delhi, cash worth 4,000 rupees, toy pistol, scooty, raincoats, gloves and shoes worn during the crime were recovered from the accused. Both had
I don't know whether at this point, is it a misspell of the word scooter?
I think that's how they say scooter.
Scooty. It just sounds so cute. Like, you know, you're a cash for gold shop. You're just, you know, winding down, kind of like, you know, customers and everything. Correct. And then suddenly Scooty. Yeah. And then two fellas just walk in raincoats. It's not raining, you know. It's hot. It's not raining.
No. Of course, it's hot. It's super hot. They're sweating underneath.
And they walk in with obviously toy gun.
Yes.
Right. Not even like the realistic looking toy gun. No. The
yellow and red color. No.
The one where you press, you get a kata 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 kata. The one got light.
Yeah. It's a normal gun, but like, you know, the one that have laser sound. You know which one I'm talking about, right?
Yes. 100%. The pew.
Like then, every time you press, it's a different one. First it goes pew.
And then for some strange reason, the fourth one is a Chinese song. For no reason, you know.
It's just Feng Tao. So the last sentence of this to describe these criminal geniuses, okay, both had lost a lot of stolen amount in gambling and betting. So I really don't know if all this was worth it, to be honest.
So these two fellas wearing raincoats and toy guns. Decided to rob cash for gold and not for a lot of money.
We're talking about decent money.
Yeah, and the best part is the police who formed a task force, a Royal Commission of Investigations.
Yeah.
Right? With police force from, you know, four different districts, right? Coming together in a profile case, CSI, you know, the people who do the psychological, you know, the profiling. And all that, and you know, for two fellas, two idiots who travel in a scooty, okay, first of all, and second of all, use toy guns and wear raincoat, which is fine if that's whatever rocks your boat, right?
Yeah.
So, this whole thing and they only steal. And the best part is the whole team found out that they are loitering around these markets, but they never arrested them.
They were doing investigation, lah. They managed to find them loitering around here.
Wait, that's the guy. Should we arrest him? Not yet.
Wait first. Let's see what they do.
And then they decided to rob another cash for gold place.
Which they were only, planning to,
which only had 4,000.
Yeah.
Rupees. And let me tell you, 4,000 rupees is a few hundred ringgit.
Yeah, lah. I think they just needed to make another urgent bet, lah. Somewhere. The bet at the horse racing.
Probably Premier League starting one. That's why they had
to Correct.
They had to put money on Man City.
Which is the one they should have put at to lose?
Yeah, Man City, lah. No, because Man City was supposed to... They're Premier League winners last season. They were playing Tottenham Hotspur, which were very much a disappointment. But they lost anyway, so they lost, lah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sure this was did the same, lah.
Yeah, this probably... Man City, lah, bro. Man City, don't worry. The 75,000 we put in Man City, we'll have millions. We'll have billions.
And we can afford carrots for the rest of our lives. Vegetables.
And then the result came out, they're like, fuck, we need to... We need 4,000.
So that's Macha news.
Okay. Well done. Thank you very much for.
Okay.
So my story is something that you probably heard of this person before.
Okay.
Right. Because you don't know a lot about this person because when they taught you in Sejarah last time also, little bit lah.
Okay.
You just mention his name and then after that they fuck off.
Okay.
Right.
Who, Sami Velu?
No lah. Sami Velu's name will forever be etched in your memory.
Okay.
Yap Aloy.
Oh.
Was born in 1837 in the Huizhou Hakka district of Guangdong province.
Okay.
Okay. The first son in a poor farming family, he received little or no formal education during his childhood.
Yeah, can I say something first before? I think that there's a trend of like people who end up being big historical names. Almost all of them come from like farming families, you know.
To be fair, one thing I like about this first story is that the trajectory one kind, lah, bro.
Oh, yes, Okay. You continue. I'm just saying, I think like if you want to be a historical figure. But you didn't start out as a child of a farming family.
Don't bother. If your biography starts with Kiran Bala Devan was born to a middle class family, forget it.
Done.
You're a lawyer. That's the best you can do.
The only people history will remember are farmers.
Yeah. No, I mean you. If you're born to a middle class family, the only way you're going to become famous or
you're going you won't.
No, the only way you're going to, you rob a bank.
You buy vegetables.
That kind of stuff, no problem.
Okay.
Because remember last story or not?
Started. Yes. That's true.
This is an excerpt of his biography at that time.
Okay.
When he was born, he was a common child.
And what does that mean? What does that mean?
There was nothing remarkable about him.
That is not a nice thing to say, you know.
I know, but they're really playing down the start, you know. They're really like, the fucker was dirt lah when he born.
So this biography is trying to build up lah.
He's trying to build up lah. And guess what? There's more. He was not very big or tall and was of average size.
Okay.
This is a biography, by the way.
Yeah. I mean, luckily he's dead when this came out. He probably would be very upset.
But when he spoke, his voice was sonorous.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't know what sonorous means, but go on.
It means commanding respect.
Okay.
I think so. Or is it loud? I also don't know.
Okay.
Today we both learned something.
Okay, Ken. You Googling, huh?
Yes. Okay, sonorous, imposingly deep and full.
Oh, so he was a small fella.
Imposing. Ah, yeah, okay. Correct.
He was a small fella. Hey, what's up, bro?
So it could be either deep or maybe it just like he everything he say sound like the main character.
okay.
You get what I'm trying to say, right?
No, but I like the way they started with this flow. Dirt the flow. Okay. Not tall the flow, not big, but even talk, bro.
Okay.
Talk, His tempo was like fire.
Okay.
And he had the strength of an elephant.
But he was small, right?
Yeah, you know, but so, he had the strength of an elephant, though. He was like, okay. He was like, what, the star sheriff, what?
Oh, Brave Star.
Huh?
Brave Star.
The one with the strength of a bear.
Yeah. Also, no, he didn't, lah, bro. let me just right out now itself say that is 100% wrong. And you can continue.
Wait, hold on. He could support the weight of 100 caddies on his two palms when he stretched his two arms forward.
100? What is caddies?
I guess it's the, you know, the one where they carry the old school, you know, there's one bamboo and then two buckets at the side.
Oh, okay.
I'm assuming that is what they meant, lah.
He could carry 100 kilos of that.
100 caddies, lah. I don't know. Maybe one is like 100 gram or I don't know.
Okay. I mean, I guess anybody could bag. Okay. Sure. No, I like how that is a thing. No, I like how that is a feature, no, of Yap Online.
Okay. He knew Chinese boxing.
Okay, that one I cannot dispute, yeah.
Okay. On his forehead, between his eyebrows, there was a mark like a Chinese character for man, Ren.
Okay.
Which he got when he was young, tending cows in the village. The story goes that once he saw two bullocks fighting. And he thought because of his exceptional strength, he could separate them.
So he thought he was strong and then he wanted to go and whack some bulls, lah.
Yes, that is the story.
Okay.
He apparently exceptional strength, he could separate them, lah, with his bare hands.
Okay.
The strength of an elephant and Chinese boxing.
Okay. It didn't happen. Okay.
Unfortunately, one of the savage animals butted him on the head.
Yes.
So he got this deep mark like the Chinese character Red.
Yeah, this is what happens when you try to get involved with wild animals, lah, doing their own thing. This is literally anyone could have seen this. The fact that he didn't die.
The fact that he got like a Chinese character in his head, that's it.
Yeah.
At age 17...
That one also, I'm sure, is because he malu or what happened. And then he just simply tell people like, hey, look, I got run on my head. And people were like, bro, it's just... You've literally been bleeding for 10 minutes. I don't know what you're talking about.
This was 10 years ago. You're still bleeding, bro. I can see your brain pulsating. Okay?
Yeah.
Where's the
character? Is it... Bro, I can see your skull. I can see that.
At the age of 17, he traveled alone to Malaya.
All right.
Landing in Malacca in 1854.
Mm.
Here he was met by another man of the name Yap.
So no, Yap. There's no mention of why he came here.
No, he just... There is many theories, but I will explain that later.
Okay, fine.
Okay? So, okay. But some places, they say that he was a very weak character.
Okay.
Where he ran away from problems.
Okay.
He got bored and then in China, so he just ran to Malaysia.
Okay.
And then later on, you will see other forms of this as well.
Okay. Right?
But some people say that he's very ambitious. So for him, he got bored in China. He's like, fuck it, I'll go to Malaya, what the hell.
See what I can do there. La.
See what happened. So at the age of 17, he traveled alone to Malaya. Landing in Malacca in 1854, there he was met by another man of the Yap surname.
Mm.
No relation.
Of
who
course.
Introduced him to his first job in a nearby tin mine.
Mm.
So when this operation closed down, he went to another relative who ran a shop in the mining town of Kasang.
Okay.
Okay. Now another excerpt from the same autobiography.
Yeah.
Okay. When Yap arrived in Malacca, he was hired as a laborer, but once again found himself with barely enough to live on. So he felt depressed and dissatisfied with himself. A fortune teller who lived with him by the name of Guo Long observed that Yap Aloy's face revealed a noble spirit. Okay, this fellow like, hey, I see your face. Your face, very good.
There's always one fellow who just has to start some shit, no?
Yeah, I know. Predicting that he would not long be a subordinate to others.
Okay.
Seeing Yap Aloy's depression, Go would comfort him with the tales of men who rose as grassroots heroes.
Mm-hmm.
And he questioned the possibility of success in scholastic and ethical pursuits for those who were poor.
Okay.
Go prophesied that one day times would change and that he would display one's abilities would be through straightforward and frank talk.
So he basically said all this rubbish and just said like, bro, I think you just be gangster lah.
You know Yap Aloy is not a gangster, right?
But I'm sure that's how what this fellow was trying to get at.
Yeah. Well, okay, we'll get to that later anyway. So a year later, his uncle, the Yap fella, right?
Yeah.
Now, when I say uncle, I don't mean uncle in the sense that father's brother or
mother. He's got no relation.
This is just uncle, like uncle.
Uncle. Okay.
So the uncle decided to send the young man back to China.
Okay.
All right. Pakila, you're not going to do anything here. So that Uncle Yap gave him money for his ticket home.
Okay.
Okay, so he said, here's some money. Take a boat to Singapore. Then from Singapore, you take another boat, go to China.
Okay.
So while waiting for his boat to sail to Singapore, Yap Aloy gambled his ticket money away and was forced to remain in Malaya.
Brilliant. That's amazing.
See, like, blackjack. Okay, here's 20 bucks. Bus already.
I got no money for boat.
picture.
I stay here.
Okay, I stay here. So, avoiding his uncle.
Okay, yeah, of course. Fuller, confirm gonna kena di.
He joined up with another relative. And the two walked north to Lukut.
From where is this
from? Malacca, la, from Malacca.
Okay.
So I don't know which port, but they walk la. That okay. Time, hey, what do they can't take a bus, taxi, Uber, you know?
Yes.
It's just like, hey, where are you going? Lukut, walk la. You know?
Okay. Sure la. Sure.
3 days later, like, macha, you told me it was like there only, macha. What the fuck?
It's still there. It's there 3 days from now.
So, they walk north to Lukut, a flourishing tin mine area in present-day Negeri Sembilan. So they went from Malacca to Negeri Sembilan. They crossed straight lines, you know.
Yeah. I understand.
Walking, But here he found work as a cook at a tin mine operated by another Huizhu Hakka named Chong Chong.
Okay. Chong Chong is not my favorite character. Wait. Oh, Abang can cook,
No.
Okay.
It was never stated anywhere that the fucker know how to cook.
Okay.
This fucker just like, what you can do? Anything. Okay, you cook.
Yeah.
Like, I can make bak kut teh.
So, we have a lot of unverified claims ready as of this point.
Oh, yeah. Look, this happened.
Already.
People writing this only wrote this after his death, by the way.
Okay. Yeah.
So, operated by another Huizhu Hakka named Chong Chong.
Chong Chong.
I love that name. And Chong within 3 years, he had saved enough money to begin a pig trading business.
Mm.
I don't know what the fuck a pig trading business is.
That means
is it like trading magic cards or what? Like, hey, this pig, bro. This pig.
So, sometimes you got the common, uncommon, the rare, and then the mythic. The legendary pig. So, that one is more rare, so you can get more for that.
I trade you my legendary pig for two epic pigs.
I tell you my normal pick for flying pig. That's exactly what it is.
So he 3 years as a cook, he earned enough money, saved up enough money to begin a pig trading business.
Okay.
Right. So now, following his expanding trading activities, he traveled to nearby Sungai Ujong.
Okay.
Okay, which is not that far away, so you gotta walk lah. Where he made the acquaintance of a certain Liu Ngim Kong, who was serving as a personal bodyguard for the Chinese Kapitan of the area, Kapitan Shin.
Okay.
Okay, so both men were Hui Zui Hakas, and Yap Aloy was taken on as another assistant bodyguard to Kapitan Shin.
Okay, and this Kapitan Fleur is, what's his deal?
Okay, so Kapitan is the captain lah, like the, so basically you are in charge of the Chinese community.
Okay.
Alright, so okay. You know how they have the Kongsi Gelap, right?
Uh-huh.
So Kapitan is the head of that lah.
Okay, so, but still you are maintaining nothing to do with gangster, huh?
No lah, my God lah.
Okay, alright, continue.
Not long afterwards, fighting erupted between the Malays and the Chinese over collection of tin revenues in the area.
Oh, so from that time also still got all these rubbish.
Oh, yeah, 24 hours fighting, lah.
I see, okay.
Yap Aloy joined in the battle on the losing side of the Kapitan Shin and Liu Ngim Kong. Liu was wounded and escaped.
Okay.
Yap Aloy, also wounded, fled into the jungle, where he hid with a family of charcoal makers.
Okay. They were there, lah. They were living in the forest?
Yeah, because they're charcoal makers, lah, bro.
You cannot make charcoal outside of a forest?
No.
Okay.
I mean, supply chain, lah, bro. I mean,
okay, sure. You know what? I know nothing. I know nothing about the charcoal industry.
No, also the fact that, look, you dug down like that. You can't go outside.
Supply chain, lah. Okay. I'll go and talk to some people about the charcoal logistics and I'll go increase my knowledge a bit.
But Kapitan Shin was much less fortunate.
Ah.
Making a wrong turn in the jungle rail, he was caught and beheaded by a group of Malays.
Oh, okay.
I mean, it's just like, you know, his ways was not working properly. He turned right, he turned left, you know.
A wrong turn in a... Okay, all right.
Yeah. According to reports, however, a miracle took place at his death.
Tell me.
So, according to reports, however, a miracle took place at his death when white blood instead of red flowed from his body.
No.
Yeah.
No.
What?
No, it.
No, but according to Malay myth, if they kill you
and white blood
you
come
have
out.
White blood, you have spilled the blood of innocence. Like for instance, okay, Masuri, right? You know the whole myth thing, and
yes.
So they accused her of something and then they killed her, but then when they killed her, it was white blood, they were like, oh shit. But little did they know that it was actually just an infection lah.
Yeah, it's just late stage leukemia, correct. The So
okay.
So this chap, now when you say according to reports is according to people who were there lah.
I mean the CCTV was not available at that time. It was under repair.
Okay. Okay. So
I mean in 1857 is constantly under repair lah.
I know. So
CCTV is just a woodpecker.
No, I'm like what I'm asking is like were these reports from official sources or from eyewitnesses? That's what I meant.
Macha, in 1857, what the fuck is official, macha?
Maybe one reporter where I was there during this gang fight, you know.
just the one reporter in the jungle. Who cutting his head,
Bro, he's 1857, they got nothing to do there. he's been there for 7 years with them. He don't know what to do really.
He took a wrong turn.
He took a wrong turn.
He couldn't get out.
Yeah, okay.
The same wrong turn. But anyway, yes. 6 months later, when the fighting had died down.
No, wait. Before that, let me just say the miracle didn't happen. Huh? Okay, continue.
Hey, could have.
No.
Okay. 6 months later, when the fighting had died down, Yap Ashak this different different character.
Yes, yes.
The principal miner in Sungai Ujong was offered the position of kapitan.
Okay.
But he turned it down, suggesting instead the appointment of Yap Ah Loy, who at the age of 24 became Sungai Ujong's new kapitan.
All right, good for him.
All right, 24, no? What were you doing at 24, bro?
I was not hiding in the jungle with charcoal makers. So I think I was doing pretty all right. All things considered.
A year later, in 1862, at the invitation of his old friend Liu Ngim Kong, who was now acting kapitan of the fledgling Kuala Lumpur area.
Okay.
Yap Ah Loy traveled north with three close friends and became Liu Ngim Kong's personal assistant.
Wait, so he left his kapitanship there to become someone's personal assistant here?
It's like Can upgrade, bro. I don't know how this hierarchy works. Like,
I mean, like, a kapitan to a personal assistant is kind of
I know, it's a step down, no? Yeah, it is. Like, I mean, I guess bigger area, you got more revenue, you know.
But then you are the kapitan of your own area, and then you go and be the personal assistant of another area's kapitan. It seems a bit, you know what I mean?
I guess it's like, okay, it's like this, right? So you play in a club called Birdly, right?
Okay.
So you're the main striker.
Okay.
You're doing well.
Okay.
Okay, but then suddenly Manchester United come along and say, hey, we want you to be a backup striker.
And then they tell you're a shit club and I don't want. Sneeze.
I'm allergic to this cat, lah. Anyway, so...
You're allergic to people talking crap by MU, I think.
I think so. Anyway, so... what do you call it? Yeah, I guess that's how it works. I don't know.
Okay, look. Let's just say that he did it for his own... He knew what he was doing, lah.
Yeah, he knew. Because the move to Kuala Lumpur marked the beginning of a period of real prosperity to the young Yap Ah Loy.
Oh.
This is back to the excerpt just now from Go, the fortune teller, right?
Yeah.
So, greatly moved by the words of the fortune teller, Yap Ah Loy lost interest in working as a laborer. With his historic spirit and chivalrous and generous nature, he gradually began mixing with the lower class elements in the marketplace.
Okay.
And before long was considered the leader of the workers.
Mm.
At this time, news came that Kuala Lumpur mines were recruiting workers with the promise of great benefits. Yap Ah Loy thus traveled to Kuala Lumpur, where he gradually became respected as a leader of the mining workers in the area.
All right. Okay. So this is Rajinikanth story, lah.
Yeah, Rajinikanth, lah. Okay. So within 2 years of being the personal assistant to the kapitan,
yeah,
he owned two tin mines of his own.
Oh.
And open a drugstore in town.
Okay.
When they say drugstore,
they mean medicine store, lah.
I don't know, lah, bro. It could be medicine store, it could be an opium shop. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, so it could be drugs or it could be drugs.
Because at that time there wasn't quite a lot of difference between drugs and drugs.
Right.
Right. Okay. Because last time, remember, that heroin was actually you can buy like cough mixture, like that, no?
Yeah, yeah. Which I've been telling a lot of people that we should bring that back.
We should put cocaine back into coke.
Yeah, I mean, might as well. The world's going to hell, Eddie. Might as well exactly. Just do all this, right? Okay. So he opened up a look, but yeah, to be very honest, I think, even if it was a normal drugstore, so you just go at the back a little bit, there'll be a mound of heroin there.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Of course, opium, heroin, cocaine, weed. It's like, you wanna not feel your headache or you want to wake up in Mantakab 3 days later?
No, because everything is a ubad, right? Ubad, yeah, ubad.
That is true. That is true. Dried fucking beetles. Not like that. No, because I remember once I went to this Chinese medicine shop, right?
Okay.
Basically for like, you know, what's the thing called when they poke pins inside you?
Acupuncture,
yes. So my knee was giving problem. Like, it's still giving problem, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But so I just thought, like, okay, let's try acupuncture, see what happens, right?
Okay.
So definitely doing acupuncture, definitely simply playing with my fucking nerves and shit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it was like playing PlayStation and that, no? Like, yeah. Oh.
Oh, he was doing you. He was having his own fun.
He was having his own fun, and he only could speak Chinese. I only could speak English. So nice. You know, the communication was great. So then he said, "Okay, you take this packet of herbs.
Okay,
you go home, you boil, and you drink.
Okay,
okay. So for I opened the packet when I got home. Fucking dried bug, scorpion.
Okay."
And some herbs, but still, mostly, it was, you know, I'm like, you know what, fuck it, I'm okay with my knee, guy. I'm okay.
You learn to live with the knee,
Yeah, it's fine, I can walk.
You know, thinking back, Kavin, if only you had taken that.
I did one. Bitter as fuck. I gave up.
It's like antibiotics. You finish the whole course. If you had finished the bag by now, bro, you will be mountain climbing,
Sure. Soon afterwards, he arranged to marry a Malacca Chinese woman and sponsored the construction of Kuala Lumpur's first Chinese temple dedicated to none other than the spirit of Kapitan Shin.
Okay.
The first Kapitan. Who, having died a miraculous death, was believed to now act as the powerful god Si Senta.
Okay, I mean,
that's what I mean. No, you it all came out.
No, you. Okay, shut up. Okay, wait first. You want to build temple? All you build, go ahead. No issue.
Okay,
but why have to involve this Capitan Fleur who 100% didn't have white blood? What is his... No, I don't get... You know what? Just build. You don't have to say that, because of the miracle. No, there wasn't a miracle, bro. He got caught, he died. That's it.
So, this is an excerpt from the biography again. So, he starts out as a strong man charged with the protection of a local community in a period of anarchy and disorder. His tiny band of followers snowballs into an army. He eventually takes over provinces and perhaps the whole country.
Wrote this thing himself.
Probably, bro. In part by battles and negotiations, but also in part by mysterious charisma, which wins him spontaneous support of all who meet him.
Okay, so 100% he wrote this. Now this biography that you're talking about.
He got Strength of Two Elephants, I remember.
Okay, yes. Okay. It was written by Anonymous.
With the initials YAL.
YAL, yeah. No, YAL, big, he put that no relation.
So now back to the story. When Liu Nghiêm Cong fell ill in 1868, he made arrangements for Yap A Loy to fill the post of Kapitan after his death.
Right.
Much to the displeasure of certain relatives of Liu, who were later to cause the great trouble to Yap A Loy in the Selangor disturbances.
I mean, it makes sense, You suddenly give another flood a job when you got own family members a bit. Because this whole Kapitan thing is all mostly family run, right?
Yeah. No, it's basically like a king. The king of that area, of the people, right? Of this thing. So, this is Kuala Lumpur, right? At this time. As soon as Yap A Loy assumed the post of Kapitan, he began to make provisions for public order.
Okay.
Publicizing a list of crimes and their punishments.
Oh, okay.
Recruiting a sizable amount of personal bodyguards and training soldiers as a possible defensive measures.
All right. Okay.
So he knew He knew already. Okay. We're going to fight, but I want to keep the peace, right?
Okay. All right.
So
these are crimes that other people did, okay. His own Kapitan group, the one they didn't say anything,
No, of course not. Okay. That's how you keep the order, bro.
Sure. You only handle other people's crimes, right? Not your own.
It's very simple. You kill, I kill you.
Okay. But if I kill, who kill me?
You kill who?
I kill you.
Wait, I'm very confused now. Who's killing who?
Okay.
That's exactly how it went. But anyway, disputes among Malay royalty over the collection of tin revenues from the growing tin fields have already flared up with the seizure of Port Klang by Raja Mahdi in 1866.
Okay.
Right. So at this point, Port Klang is this thing. So when Yap Ah Loy took over as Kuala Lumpur's capital in 1868, Raja Mahdi organized a lavish ceremony for his inauguration.
Mm.
Okay. Partly as a move to legitimize his own position.
Okay.
In 1869, Klang was again besieged and finally retaken by Tengku Kudin.
Alright.
The younger brother of the Kedah Sultan, a new son-in-law of the Sultan of Selangor, and an ally of Yap Ah Loy.
Oh, he got connection lah.
So this Tengku Kudin fella, if you read the history, what he did was, so this was different story lah. So Diffler was like, okay, you know what? I want to take over Port Klang.
Okay.
Because, you know, Port Klang.
Because of the satay.
Satay in Port Klang. Isn't it Kajang?
Sorry. Isn't it the whole of Klang?
Yeah, no, Klang Bakute lah. You want to take over the Bakute.
Oh, Klang is Bakute.
You want to take over the Bakute shops.
Okay.
So anyway. So he
I doubt, but okay.
He went to Port Klang. And then he decided, then he's like, okay, you know, Yap Ah Loy, bro, you my brother, right? My brother. So they fought this Raja Mahdi fella, and then he took over. So now Tengku Kudin,
yes,
is the this thing of Port Klang. So now legitimizes Yap Ah Loy more also.
Okay.
Because, you know, he got, what do you call that? Connection lah.
Okay, yeah, sure. Okay, I get it. So now he got royal backing. He's got the backing of the workers. He's got soldiers.
Yes.
Okay.
So in addition to the Malay dissension over tax collection, the Chinese in the area around Kuala Lumpur were divided into competing camps, which vied for control over the area's tin fields.
Mm.
So in Kuala Lumpur itself, Yap Ah Loy was the head of mostly the Hui Zhu Hakas.
Okay.
Which is where he's from. While the north in Kanching, the Jia Ying Zhu Hakas supported other leaders.
Okay.
Okay, listen. So in the Chinese community itself, right? Chinese as a big umbrella, they got the Tochus, they got the Hakas, they got the Mandarins, and so forth.
Right? Yes. Okay.
So within the Hakas itself,
They don't like each other.
They also don't like each other because they got the Hui Yu, they got the Yang Yu, Ya Ying Yu. So all these people also, they also fighting each other.
It's just any excuse to fight other people. This is a Asian thing, you know.
It's very Asian. No, the problem is the Asian thing is, you know how, like, you know, people say like white people are the most racist people in the world.
Yeah, no, they're not.
No, they're not. They're not. Indians and Chinese. We are racist to ourselves, you understand?
Yeah. Historically,
Exactly. You're Hokkien, Hokkien. Oh, you Penang Hokkien. You go fuck yourself. I don't like you.
still the same Hokkien, but from a, like, you just because you're from different city,
Cannot.
Different state. Cannot.
Now, if Penang Hokkien, I also Penang Hokkien. Which part of Penang? The north side or Tiu Ni Asing? I'm from the south side.
This extends to Chinese and Indian people. We just
worse, bro.
We cannot.
Malali, what kind of Malali? Which caste?
It's at this point, bro. If like you are a Malali and somebody else is another Malali, okay, but you are from SS5 and they are from SS4, cannot live. It's that bad.
Wow, outside of India also throw,
This is bad shape, bro.
Thus, the complicated battles of Selangor Wars lasting from 1870 to 1873 involved the Chinese and Malays on both sides.
Okay.
So, the fighting seesawed back and forth with when tipped against Yap Ah Loy with the desertion of several Malay allies. Kuala Lumpur fell to the enemy in 1872, but was retaken by Yap Ah Loy with the help of Tengku Kudin and Malay soldiers from Pahang in 1873. The Selangor Sultan now installed Yap Ah Loy as the capitan of Kuala Lumpur for the second time.
Wow.
So Tunku Kuddin became the Sultan of Selangor. So
and then he basically installed this chap as the Mandel.
Exactly lah. So he's the capitan of Kuala Lumpur lah.
Okay.
So the city and mining region to which Yap Ah Loy returned had been devastated by 3 years of civil war.
Okay.
But he was determined to restore the mines to the city to their former prosperity.
Okay.
With his personal fortune largely depleted by the recent fighting, Yap Ah Loy was forced to borrow heavily from merchants in Malacca and Singapore.
Oh no. Okay.
Okay. As a means of obtaining cheaper supplies for his workers, he encouraged local Malays to settle in the area and grow rice for him.
Hmm.
Okay. Despite many of his efforts, Kapitan Yap was on the verge of bankruptcy in 1878, when the prices of tin suddenly doubled, enabled him to recoup his losses and pay his debts.
Oh, damn lucky, right?
Damn lucky. And once again, became Selangor's wealthiest man.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. So the British at that time occupied Singapore and the Johor Harbour.
I was waiting for when these fellows will start to
come. So the British already in Singapore. So now they already went to Johor Harbour, where they collected land rents and prevented deep penetration into the peninsula by others.
Rent for what? Your country, is it?
They came. They is just ready, lah.
Okay.
The Chinese, meanwhile, were involved in tin mining businesses in Singapore and Penang.
Hmm.
As their numbers grew, they engaged in fights with the locals.
Who? The British?
Yeah, no. This is the Chinese fellas.
Oh, okay.
So the Chinese fellas came here, mine. Then the Malay fellas like, hey, what are you doing? Why are you digging my land? The fellas like, hey, what you want now?
Okay.
This is an oversimplification of what the problem is.
I'm very sure it's exactly what happened. You're not wrong, huh?
So as their numbers grew, they engaged in fights with the locals, which prompted the king of Johor to issue an order expelling all Chinese from the area.
Oh, okay. They told all of them the chawla to get out.
The king said, "Your please get out. Please."
Okay.
Okay.
Why the king sound like Obama?
I don't know.
Okay.
Please get out.
Stop it.
At this time, Yap Ah Loy's kinsmen in Johor numbered some 300 people.
Okay.
And they discussed organizing resistance to the local king and elected Yap Ah Loy as their generalissimo.
Alright.
Okay. Although they were victorious in their early battles, they feared the king's revenge and turned to China for some 10,000 kinsmen to join them in the fighting.
Oh, they asked for troops, lah.
Hello, China, bro. We came here 300 plus.
Brother.
So 300 people, we fight. We win. Not bad.
But we want to win some more.
The Yap fella very good. I tell you, Yap fella. He became generalissimo.
Okay. Listen. You don't talk so much. You tell me how much you want. How much you want?
I want 10,000 only.
10,000.
Hey, you got 1 billion, ma. People.
10,000. I can do 5.
Come on, okay. Tell you what. You send me 10. I give you free umbrella.
3 free umbrella.
Wait, you're going less. You supposed to go up.
3 free umbrella.
Oh, 3. Ah. Oh. Okay, I give you 2 free umbrella. Okay, and a high five.
What's a high five?
not yet invent yet, but I tell you, when we win this war, high five, very, very expensive.
Oh, investment, high five. Okay, I take. Bro, because you know the Chinese contact there would have haggled for the number of people. You know,
correct.
Right?
Correct. And turned to China for some 10,000 kinsmen to join them in the fighting, which lasted for 8 years and included all of Johor as well as Penang.
That's a long fight.
Yeah. Leading his army, Yap Ah Loy finally stabilized the whole area and obtained the land from the barbarian kings. Okay, listen. Okay. I didn't write this. Okay, it was already.
No, Yabala wrote this. I'm very sure, like Yabala himself wrote this.
However, because the English were also interested in controlling this area, an economic and political struggle began. Now, as the British were backed by a strong government, but the overseas Chinese of that period were still considered pirates of by the Qing authorities.
Yeah.
So the Qing dynasty, they're like, oh, you get out of China, you are a pirate. Okay?
Okay.
So Yap Ah Loy had no alternative but to turn over sovereignty of the whole territory to the British and was barely able to retain control of his own private land. So he was very pro-British lah, in a way. Like, you know, we don't want trouble with the British. Y'all got fucking guns and shit. At least the other okay. friends fighting with spears. Okay, y'all got guns, right? You know what? Take some land lah. You take some land.
This is why I'm always sad lah. All this fighting within... Asians fighting with Asians, right?
Mm-hmm.
But when push comes to shove, when we're supposed to fight the invaders, we didn't fight properly, you know?
No, you have to understand, when they were fighting each other, they were fighting with sticks and spears.
No, never mind, bro. Just fight only.
But then these fuckers came with fucking cannons and guns, bro. They were like...
So you fight smart, bro. This fella can tap out two bulls. You're telling me he cannot fight?
This is not Ghost of Tsushima, no, bro.
Bro, he got two elephant strength, bro. He got two elephant strength, bro.
Yeah, but two elephants is all one gun enough, bro.
I feel that... In this portrayal of Yap Ah Loy, that Yap Ah Loy himself obviously wrote, I feel you're not giving him enough credit. I think he could have one v one the British.
Well, technically it'd be 2v1 because it's two elephants.
Two elephants, correct.
Yes, but they are not elephant. They are like, you know, something else.
Assholes.
Correct. So, meanwhile, this was in Johor, right? So, meanwhile, the British had established themselves at Klang. So they started moving in lah. When they moved their administration to Kuala Lumpur in 1879, Yap Ah Loy relinquished some of his powers as administrator but continued to represent the Chinese community as capitan in dealings with the British and Malays.
Mm.
Right? So basically, one of the duties of capitan is to be the supplier of opium to the Chinese fellas.
Okay. You see? Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
So that he kept lah, but mostly he was still the leader of the Chinese.
If it was me, I would also only keep that. If you give me a chance to keep anything, I would just keep the opium, yes.
He also not only continued as a major tin magnate, but built roads, invested in various agricultural schemes, and was the first to import a steam pump for the use of Selangor mines.
Nice.
As a philanthropist, he built a refuge which offered free food and shelter to the sick, and he led the building of Kuala Lumpur's first Chinese school.
So he actually good heart lah.
He got good heart lah, but you know the opium was you know.
Hey, maybe he didn't get high on his own supply. Maybe he never touched the opium at all.
Maybe we'll find out.
Okay. Oh.
In 1881, a flood swept through the town of Kuala Lumpur.
Yeah, okay. So again, nothing's changed, huh?
Nothing's changed, yes. In 1881, a flood swept through the town of Kuala Lumpur following a fire which engulfed it earlier.
Following a fire. So fire and then water.
And then water. They were I think like they were praying to the, you know, the temple.
Captain Planet.
the Capitan Shin.
Oh, temple. Right.
Because the miraculous fella. So they were like, you know, fire was coming. Please give us water. And suddenly, the fella,
can you
please stop the water?
It's too much.
No. You know, a little bit water enough. So that's what happened. These successive problems destroyed the town structures made of wood and atap.
Mm.
Right? As a response, Frank Swettenham, the British resident of Selangor.
Yeah. This motherfucker. Okay.
Required the buildings to be constructed of brick and tile.
Okay.
Hence, Capitan Yap Ah Loy bought a sprawling piece of real estate and the setting up of brick industry, which would spur the rebuilding of Kuala Lumpur.
Alright.
This place is the eponymous Brickfields.
Okay.
So
that's where it gets its name from.
Yes, Brickfields is basically the... So, okay. So, Frank Swettenham said, no, everything must be built by bricks. So, Yap Ah Loy said, Macha, we make a brick factory, we're going to be like, you know, Paki make it rich. So he built a brick factory in that place called, at that time was called the jungle.
Yeah.
And then...
As was many places.
As was many places. So he built that place. And then because it made bricks, guess what? It's called Brickfields. I never knew this was the history of Brickfields.
I also didn't know. Yeah.
I also didn't know Brickfields was founded by a Chinese fella.
Oh, no. That one is the entire of KL. That one I know. I didn't know that it was called Brickfields literally because at one point they probably had a field full of bricks there. That is more unbelievable to me than
exactly.
Of course, the entire of KL was found by Chinese people. That one everybody knows. It's fine.
Destroyed atap buildings were replaced with brick and tiled ones. Yap also restructured the building layout of the town. Many of the new brick buildings mirrored those shop houses in southern China, characterized by the 5-foot ways. As well as skilled Chinese carpentry work.
Huh.
This result in a distinct electric shop house architecture typical of this region.
Wow. Not bad, la. Wow.
Yeah, it was very difficult, la.
Who, you want to take a drink of water after that?
I forgot the water.
Okay.
In this developing town, Yap owned a third of all the buildings in Kuala Lumpur.
Sure.
And 2/3 of the urban land east of the Klang River.
Where is the east of Klang River?
You know the Klang River? East.
No, I know. I'm trying to see east is what area then now. Oh, okay.
Cheras lah.
Yeah, okay, sure. Because why not? Because of course it's Cheras.
No, I don't know if it's Cheras.
I'm sure it was also Cheras.
In addition to his control of the tin mines, Yap Aloy also spent a sum of $20,000.
Dollars, huh?
In 1880 something. Okay.
Okay.
So $20,000, which is a lot of money, to expand the access in the city significantly, linking up tin mines in the city. These roads include the main arterial roads of Ampang Road, Road, and Petaling Street.
Foo. Okay, so those were the originally those roads were used for your famous supply chain, lah.
Yes, lah, correct.
Okay.
No, but here's the thing, though. I mean, Taling Street, right? So
He's
not only the founder of Chinatown; he's also the founder of Little India.
Yeah.
And Ampang Road, like you know, the most Malay place in the world.
Yeah, lah. Jalan Ampang. He did everything, lah.
No, actually, Jalan Ampang are mostly white people now. All the fucking embassies.
Oh, you're right. No. We're talking back then, lah. Before the country went down the drain.
No, then all Chinese. But in 1885, just as he was planning to return to China for a long-awaited visit, Yap Aloy fell ill with bronchitis.
Ayo.
An abscess of the left lung.
Ayya.
So he made little recovery before he died on April 1885 at the age of 47.
You mean the bugs couldn't save him? the bugs.
No lah. No, actually, look, he refused modern medicine and favored traditional medicine instead.
So that's why lah. Okay, continue.
He like no heroin.
Yep.
Give me the scorpion.
Yeah, give me the powdered scorpion. tea.
The doctor examined Yap's body later and confirmed that his death was either due to heart failure or poisoning by the fumes of charcoal brazier.
Okay.
It's two fucking very different things, you know.
I was about to say. Who's
like,
his
the doctor?
Doctor
is like, either the fella died of a heart attack or lung failure. Maybe even pancreatic cancer, maybe even a
food. Either this is my theory. Either those predictions are correct or this fellow wasn't a real doctor.
Wait, don't yet finish yet. Okay. Oh. So this is my favorite part of the whole story, which is the end. So the doctor examined Yap's body and later confirmed that his death was either due to heart failure or poisoning by fumes of charcoal brazier. The doctor also noticed the exceptional brightness of his eyes.
No la. That's not something.
Yeah, I know. Like what? Like what you open is like eyes shown, is it? Like fucking two LEDs in the night.
This is the 1800s, you know, the late 1800s.
Yeah.
Okay. 1885 in KL. I'm sure the doctor got so many other dead bodies to go and visit that night. He got no time to spend complimenting a corpse's eye, you know.
Look at the eyelashes. Look at the baby blues on his brown eyes.
Whoever Yabalai paid to write this documentary, this
died to who is he paying?
No, he would have paid someone before he died to say, okay, after I die, make sure you write something nice. Make it overly nice, right? Whoever he paid this one, I think just went nuts with it. just toko tamba like nobody's business.
He got nice.
He had to fit in one last one thing there, even after he died. He had what? How was it described again?
His
what?
Exceptional brightness of his eyes.
Okay, yeah, sure. He's dead, you know.
Yeah. How do you fucking?
That is literally when the light goes out of your eyes. So how? What bright? They put the candle a bit too close. Is it? What's going on?
His eyes caught fire, and they were like, "Wait, bright are the eyes? Macha, his eyes were fire lah." Sorry.
The bloody gaslight on top there was like a bit too bright. Wow, the bugger eyes! Damn, do you have a certificate, bro?
It's probably the Chinese medicine blur lah.
Yeah, for sure.
How did he die? Either heatiness or charcoal. You're not sure. Either what?
You literally, your job is to be sure, though. Can you?
Exactly. No. it's just like, it's either or. Like, you know, it's either his foot had gangrene or his eyes had glaucoma. You can't just two separate parts of the body, you understand what I'm saying?
No, brother, if I was going to guess why I call you, I could have just guessed, you know, myself. Come on, la. I understand it's 1885, bro, but like, can you...
Can you stop complimenting his eyes for 2 minutes, bro?
Ooh, maybe stop looking at the eyes, look, and just look at the rest of his body, bro. Can you...
Actually, wow. You know what? You know, just stop looking at the body. Get the fuck out, bro.
Yeah. You know what? You gave me two choices. I'm scared you're going to give me more. Just leave.
He was also 48 years old when he died.
That's young.
Yeah, very young. I mean, but in 1885, I guess that's the
age limit.
not age limit, but the average lifespan.
I mean, yeah.
The average lifespan was probably 30. He overshot by 15 years. You understand?
That's nice. That's nice. Yeah. That's good.
I still cannot. The doctor also noticed exceptional brightness of his eyes.
Okay.
He is buried in the large Kwong Tong Cemetery in Kuala Lumpur.
Okay.
And that is the story of Yapaloy.
Right. I mean, he... A lot of people know the name.
Yes.
But... Like you said, not a lot of people know how he came up, what he did.
So, he actually
was pretty much involved with a lot of stuff in, not just in Malaya.
I mean, Kuala Lumpur was his domain, right? So, he went to a few places, but he became the capitan of Kuala Lumpur. And when he became the Kuala Lumpur capitan, he actually developed it. In the sense that, you know, for the betterment of Kuala Lumpur itself, like, for instance,
correct.
You know, he created the brick fields, the roads, the railways and stuff like that. So he actually organized a lot of things because, you know, that was his domain.
He made the city into into the city, lah.
Yes, basically, yeah. Yes. And also made it into like the proper Chinatown, you know, townhouses with the shops and stuff like that. The fact that, look, at the end, the British couldn't give two shits about Kuala Lumpur at the time. Also, the fact that...
They were busy stealing resources from every other state. Right?
Every other state. So, then eventually when Kuala Lumpur became very nice, and the British said, hey, you know, Klang, we fucked up already. Can we move to Kuala Lumpur for this thing? Quite nice for this place.
Yeah.
So, they moved to Kuala Lumpur. That became the capital.
Yep.
So yeah, I mean, in the history books, you always learn that, you know, not so much the founder of Kuala Lumpur, but the developer of Kuala Lumpur, right? But everybody, it's kind of stuck that the founder of Kuala Lumpur, Yap Aloy, he didn't find Kuala Lumpur, but he developed it.
He also made it into what it would have eventually become. Like, yeah, he was the one who kickstarted.
Yeah. I mean, of course, he made a shit ton of money doing that.
I mean, if not, why do it? You know?
Yeah, if not, why? I mean, the opium business was fucking amazing at that time.
Yeah. He had what? Opium, la, tin, la.
Tin, pig trading.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, he still maintained, even until.
Oh, yeah, the pig trading is still there. Wait, he still got his rare pigs there.
Oh, yo.
His magical rare pigs. His
fire water type. Rare foil pig.
Yeah, no, the rarest one is the air pig. Then, so yeah, so but the thing is, like, we never knew what he actually did, what he, you know, what his contributions were. But so yeah, this is a brief. You can go read more. Like, this came from
I would suggest if anybody wants to know more, please go and read more from someone who Yabala didn't pay to write. Like.
No, this came from a scholar paper, right? So yeah, one of the papers that this thing. So I was reading it, and they also like, okay, so you know, there's a lot of different autobiographers, but this one is like, you know, of the autobiographers were very mean to him, like not flattering to him.
Okay, sure.
Right, but it was 1 out of 10 kind of thing.
Okay.
So this guy. Okay, so the guy who didn't write it flatteringly was also the writer of the the biography for the remember the capitan who made him the capitan?
Yes.
That fellow's relative.
Ah, okay, no wonder. So that makes sense.
It was flattering to him, but not flattering to Yabalo. You understand?
Okay.
So it made so Yabalo look like a coward.
Sure, because he was that fellow's relative.
Yes.
So this fellow who wrote this biography that you've been taking the excerpts from, he went completely the other direction.
The other direction. But he didn't speak bad of the other capitan.
No, because because this guy, Kavin, now I think I just realized, I think he was in love with Yapaloy.
Okay.
So that's why his last ending thing was he had bright, beautiful eyes. This entire story was his like love letter. He's crying while he wrote this, bro. You know?
The exceptional brightness of
this. Yeah. And then the other 8 people who actually wrote neutral biographies don't know where they ended up.
No, I mean this is when I wrote it, it was together with all the
I know.
Funny parts.
Yeah.
So The one that was not flattering was saying that this guy was a coward, that he ran away from things because from China, he ran away to KL, and then, he ran away to Malacca, and then the first sign of trouble, he ran away to Lukut, and then the first sign of trouble, he ran to Kuala Lumpur, and then Kuala Lumpur also, basically, he didn't want to govern as much, so he gave all his governance to the British, and then he just basically made the money in the opium trade. And then, you know, basically, like, all the deeds that he did also is not him who did it. It was basically the people under him who basically, hey, we need roads. Can we build a road? I felt like, whatever. Lah. So, he built a road.
Oh, so that one basically said he was, like, kind of the Steve Jobs. Lah,
okay. So, yeah. Lah. So, to be fair, you believe what you want to believe. Lah.
Yes. I think this type of story, so it's hard to verify. You believe what you want to believe, but also have limits. Lah. You know, don't believe until... you know, people are bleeding white blood and...
Has bright, beautiful eyes.
Has bright, beautiful eyes after he dies.
Death.
I mean...
In death.
You know, maybe he did in life.
Maybe.
Maybe I will even say, I will even go so far as say, maybe when the doctor was examining him, maybe his eyes were still bright and beautiful.
Maybe.
Possibly. But really bloody not necessary, you know, for you to say at that point. Okay. That's all I'm saying.